When you think of Kakadu, you don't think of beaches. Well, we're on a remote beach at a place called West Alligator Head in Kakadu National Park. It's at the end of one of the four-wheel drive tracks you can take over here. We're going to take you from this remote beach to another remote beach in Arnhemland. So why not join us on our adventure through Kakadu and beyond? We discover the amazing sights of Kakadu, including yellow waters, bushfires, ancient landscapes with World Heritage rock art, prolific bird life and idyllic waterfalls. Then we enter mysterious Arnhemland to see giant crocs and bizarre insects up close. Fish for barramundi in lost lagoons. Walk through catacombs under mountains. See the magnificent hidden art of Arnhemland. Visit the lost settlement at Port Essington and much more. Kakadu's coastal area has long stretches of sandy beaches which attract campers and fishermen. But the area is not without its dangers. Because of the huge tides around here, it's a long way to go out there to have a swim, which is probably a good thing because it's not advisable to swim here. There are too many estuarine crocodiles around, and they're very dangerous. Most people don't expect to see crocodiles on the beach, but here is evidence that they also enjoy a sunbake on the sand. It pays to be alert for crocs when exploring these coastal regions. Most of Kakadu's coast is lined with mangrove forests, which are important nurseries for many fish, including the north's most popular fish, the barramundi. A walk through the mangroves at low tide reveals the twisted root systems of the stilted mangrove, one of the 20 species of mangrove in Kakadu. Mangrove seeds float and can take root in new areas where they collect silt and steadily increase the land surface of Kakadu. Hermit crabs drag their shell homes through the mangrove roots, seeking protection from predatory birds. We need protection from the millions of biting sandflies that also inhabit the mangrove areas. But it's still worth a close-up look at these primeval trees that live in salt water. Heading south from Pocock Beach at West Alligator Head, we pass through lightly wooded forests and rainforest areas that give way to pandanus groves before we cross wide grassy plains. As we head south from the beach, we have to cross this huge floodplain. It's called the Manassee Floodplain. In the wet season, it's metres and metres deep with water, but of course it's the dry season now and it's open to drive across, and it's a huge flat area. This is a treacherous area to drive on just after rain. The four-wheel drive track crosses the Manassee floodplains, and after driving 80 rough kilometres, we reach the sealed Arnhem Highway that comes in from Darwin. When you come into Kakadu National Park, you'll get this guide. In the middle, you'll find a map. Before you start driving around, look at the map first because it will save you doing a lot of backtracking. There's lots of driving around Kakadu to see some of the interesting places. Before exploring Kakadu by road, we've decided to take a look at the park from the air. Heading north to Van Diemen Gulf, we pick up the mighty South Alligator River, Kakadu's biggest river. The South Alligator is tidal and it's huge, measuring kilometres across near its mouth. The river meanders across the floodplains that cover hundreds of square kilometres. This isolated area is impossible to reach on land, and it's a haven for feral pigs. Pigs cause tremendous damage to the wetlands. and they're difficult to eradicate because they tend to live on these isolated floodplains and around billabongs. Wild pigs have been known to attack humans, and if encountered in the bush, should give them a wide berth. You may see some wild pigs in Kakadu, but it's unlikely that you'll see water buffalo anymore. They've been eradicated from the park. Buffalo were introduced to Australia by the British in 1825 at Port Essington as beasts of burden for the isolated settlement on Cobourg Peninsula. They ran wild and tore up the land. In the 1970s, the buffalo population of the area was around 200,000. Buffalo were caught live for the export meat trade in the 70s and early 80s. It took wild methods to catch the wild buffalo. I was sitting on a wooden box to film these scenes because the day before, the buffalo ripped out the passenger seat with its sharp horns. These buffalo were destined for the meatworks and eventually would have ended up on American hamburgers. Today, buffalo meat is a delicacy. Buffalo are no longer part of the Kakadu landscape. The area is still recovering from years of damage they caused, and today the biggest animal in the park is the estuarine crocodile. We're flying low along the South Alligator River. We're a long way inland and the tide is going out. The flat nature of the lowlands means the river is tidal 100 river kilometres inland. The further upstream we go, the shallower the water becomes and we start to see large estuarine crocodiles. These are dangerous potential man-eaters. When the tide's out up here, the South Alligator River looks like a dirty, muddy trench with a metre or less of brown water at the bottom. The big crocs have nowhere to hide and we count over 20 large crocodiles in 1 minute as we fly up the river. As they thrash about in the muddy water below, I just hope the chopper engine doesn't fail. I'd hate to be swimming in there. It's an amazing sight and one that puts a few shivers up your spine. This is really nature in the raw. This is not the first sign of an early wet season in Kakadu. They're not clouds, it's smoke. It's a dry season in Kakadu National Park, and you often see lots of fires burning. They seem to burn really fast through an area and then die out, leaving everything black. But of course that'll change when the next wet comes around. Fire has played a major role in the shaping of today's plant communities in the Australian environment. Over thousands of years, Aboriginal people have used fire in many ways, including burning the bush to clean the country before the hot, dry weather comes. They also use fire to flush out animals, to hunt for food, and to promote new grass to attract more animals for hunting. Birds of prey are attracted to the smoke for the same reason. They circle overhead waiting for small animals fleeing the fire. Most fires you see in Kakadu these days are controlled burnings, carried out to lessen the possibility of hot wildfires in the late hot dry season. Hot wildfires destroy everything in their path, whereas controlled low intensity burns in a patchwork pattern, like this one, only burn the dry undergrowth and grasses, helping to rejuvenate the areas. Fires are part of the Kakadu landscape in the popular dry season, so you have to be extra careful when driving through thick smoke. Travelling through tropical wetlands, we're heading south on a sealed road to visit an oasis in the rocky country of the Arnhemland Plateau. The major geological feature of Kakadu is the impressive Arnhemland Plateau, which covers less than a quarter of the park. This is off the beaten track for most tourists to Kakadu. This majestic and mysterious area is known by the local Aboriginals as Stone Country. The Arnhemland Plateau is made up of ancient sandstone that has weathered over millions of years, creating a landscape of immense beauty that's almost impenetrable on land, like a lost world. The imposing rock face of the plateau has become known as the escarpment. It varies in height from 30 metres to 300 metres. Below is tropical woodlands, and cutting into the escarpment are numerous small and large gorges. Streams cascade over the escarpment in the wet season, and even now in the dry season, the reduced flow of water tumbles into permanent rock pools at its base. This picture postcard setting is on Waterfall Creek, and known by its Aboriginal name, Gunlong. These waters run into the headwaters of the mighty South Alligator River that we saw from the helicopter. It's a great spot to cool off, before we take the four-wheel drive track into Margie, a hidden oasis in the Arnhemland Plateau. It's worth stopping along the way to photograph the bright colours of the season's wildflowers and get a taste of the country.
This flower here is known as a honey grevillea. It's called a honey grevillea because there's honey in the flower. The Aboriginals used to use this as a bush food. It tastes like honey. Very sweet.
Barramundi Gorge, or Margie, as the Aboriginals call the area, is on Barramundi Creek. And it's not long before we're walking through the spring-fed, crystal-clear waters of the creek. The walking track will lead us up to the escarpment. It's a pleasant shaded walk through the monsoon forest that fringes the cool waters of Barramundi Creek. The permanent pools support the lush forest in dry times.
We can see freshwater turtles and little fish in here. The water's so clear, it's amazing.
These crystal clear pools of the escarpment forest are home to a number of freshwater fish varieties, including four kinds of rainbow fish. Long-necked turtles also inhabit these pools. They can survive when creeks dry up by burrowing themselves in the soft mud. They continue to live even when the mud dries like concrete. They absorb fat reserves in their bodies as they wait for the next rains to come. We take a break before we tackle the climb up to the top of the escarpment. Sitting quietly by the pool, we observe a stone curlew near the water's edge. It's rare to see curlews in the daytime. They're mostly nocturnal birds. Red-tailed black cockatoos feed on the seeds of this tall tree, and they're not at all worried about our presence. The males have bright red tails, which are easily seen when they fly. It's fascinating to watch them pick and choose a sprig of fruit and carefully tear it apart with their vice-like beaks to get to the seeds. A boulder-strewn slope makes the next part of the walk a bit more difficult, with a temperature in the 30 degree mark. Once on the top of the escarpment, we get a marvellous view. These thickly vegetated valleys hide some amazing natural scenery. It makes you wonder who was first to walk in here to discover this hidden oasis. From here we can see the sandstone and monsoon forest we've just walked through.
Well, we've reached the end of the track and it's well worth the walk.
The Margie area consists of a series of small falls and deep plunge pools that have been etched into the rock over thousands of years. Water pouring over the rock from the plateau above has created a natural set of permanent small pools and a huge long permanent pool at the base of the main waterfall. This is a popular spot for the adventurous visitor to Kakadu. Margie is one of Kakadu's less known spots, even though it has been known to the Aboriginal for generations. It's of extreme importance in the overall ecology of Kakadu, so visitor numbers are naturally kept low because of the four-wheel drive only track and the moderately difficult walk up the gorge and onto the Arnhemland Plateau. During the wet season, estuarine crocodiles have been known to inhabit the gorge, so it's swimming at your own risk, even though the likelihood of any crocodiles being here today is very remote. One of the most recognised landscape features of Kakadu would have to be Norlangie Rock. Looking a bit like a giant sandstone birthday cake, Norlangie Rock is an impressive sight from the Arnbarnbarn walking track that circles the Arnbarnbarn billabong. The billabong is drying up and is getting towards the end of the dry season, and most of the birds that inhabit this area have moved on to more remote and larger billabongs.
Kakadu is renowned for its rock art, and most people that come here come to see the rock art. And some of the best of it's over there at Norlangie Rock. We're going to take you there and show some of it to you right now.
Boardwalks make easy going through some of the rocky crevices and lead us to otherwise hidden art sites in this spectacular sandstone country. The rock art is extremely important to the Aboriginal owners of Kakadu. It provides them with a positive link with the past.
When you're walking around the art sites, make sure you stick to the walking trails and the boardwalks because they're here to protect the paintings, and you can get very close to them without getting past the boardwalks.
A large viewing platform allows visitors to see this occupation site. For about 20,000 years, mostly during the wet seasons, generations of Aboriginal people have called this overhanging cave home. Grinding hollows in the rocks here were made by grinding seeds with a harder rock, like a mortar and pestle. Over generations, the people living here decorated the walls of their shelter with elaborate paintings. The paintings often depicted their daily lives, such as this hunting scene with a hunter spearing a wallaby. This image of a flintlock rifle would have been painted in what is known as the contact period, when white man first came into this area. These are spirit figures, and they're believed to have been painted for the purpose of magic and sorcery. Further along the track, we come face to face with this man, a dangerous spirit who kills women and eats them. Just around the corner, we arrive at the Arnhemland Gallery, the most famous in Norlangi. This striking gallery of X-ray art was painted in 1964 by the great rock artist Barramundi Charlie. This is Namagon, the lightning man. The stone axes on his elbows and knees are used to hit the ground or clouds to make lightning and thunder, and the band encircling his body represents lightning. This white figure is the wife of the lightning man, and below we see men and women in family groups travelling through the area on their way to a ceremony. The dominant figure up high is Namunjolk, a dangerous spirit. The white feather on the back of his headdress can be seen today on the prominent face of Norlangi Rock. This is best viewed from a lookout on a steep walking track above the painting site. We also get fabulous views of the plains and the Kakadu escarpment from the lookout.
Kakadu has been a popular place for a long time. In fact, before it was a national park, there was a place here called Morella Park, which was one of the first safari camps that was operated up in this area. I was here in 1967, and it was the first time I actually went to Norlangi and saw those magnificent paintings there.
Tourism was still in its infancy in the area. I flew into the safari camp where the tour guide drove three of us to Norlangi Rock. The Arnhemland billabong looked a lot less attractive then, while buffalo had churned up the ground, turning the billabong into a muddy hole. We visited the main art site at Norlangi. The paintings were only a few years old and very distinct. We were also shown a hidden burial cave somewhere nearby. Since I filmed these scenes, someone has souvenired the skulls that were missing on a later visit in the 70s. Today, sensitive areas are strictly out of bounds to visitors, and heavy fines are imposed on people breaking the rules. Tourism has come a long way since the 60s. Today we can enjoy a river tour with local Aboriginal guides.
The name of our boat cruise, Guliyambi. Guliyambi means paperbark raft. On the left hand side we have Arnhemland, on the right hand side, Kakadu National Park. So the East Alligator River is a border between the two lands. Now if you see any birds or crocodiles, let us know. We'll slow the boat down, get it in a good position so you get some photos. And if someone accidentally falls in, we ain't diving in after them. It's not in our job description. So I see most of the husbands have put the wives on the outside.
And just around the corner, we spot our first croc, who seems to be eyeing off these fishermen. And there's another one in the water. Some estimates of the estuarine crocodile population in the East Alligator River say there are 20 crocs per kilometre of river, and I can believe that. Some are really big. The Guliyambi cruise takes us through scenically spectacular country and offers a great opportunity to see crocodiles and stunning scenery in the one area. You definitely don't come to Kakadu for the swimming. It's hard to imagine what it was like for the Aboriginal people who fished and hunted these waters on paperbark rafts. It's a wonder they came back from their fishing trips. I'm glad we're in an aluminium boat. This large freshwater croc is having his lunch. They're regarded as harmless to humans as they mainly eat fish, but no one's putting their hands in the water. Forbidden Arnhemland is tantalising, as we view some odd-shaped, rocky outcrops. Mick puts the boat ashore so we can all briefly step into Arnhemland. Here Mick explains some Aboriginal culture and skills.
Let's go to a floodplain, a billabong, and stand there and watch which direction the magpie geese are coming from. When they go to descend into the billabong or the floodplain, the men will go up to the treetops, cut out a little opening, build a platform, and stand on that platform. So when the magpie geese start to descend, they just stand there and just spear them. They're very flexible, very light. What the women will do is wear it over the top of the head, so got two hands free, go along, collect everything, throw it in the back. The mothers also make large ones, put pipe bark inside, that's nice and cushy and soft, carry the newborn babies in. A basket like that would take nearly 2 weeks to make.
A tune on the didgeridoo seems appropriate to end our cruise. Sealed roads lead to Kakadu's main attractions, but sidetracks beckon us to areas more off the beaten track. Four-wheel drive tracks often lead to hidden treasures like Red Lily Billabong. To get there, we're driving across a dry South Alligator River floodplain. And this is how high the water gets in the wet season. You can see all this debris stuck on the tree here, just over a metre deep. All this area will be totally underwater. You wouldn't be able to get anywhere near Red Lily Billabong then. The lowland areas of Kakadu contain extensive wetlands and floodplains, which are dotted with picturesque permanent billabongs in the dry season.
Red Lily Billabong is an ideal secluded campsite. It's the essence of Kakadu. Just look at that there. What more could you ask for?
Billabongs are like a supermarket to Aboriginal people. Water lilies are delicious. The roots are cooked and the seeds from the flower pods are like pine nuts. They can be eaten raw or ground into flour for cooking. Abundant bird life provides meat in the diet, and the waters of the billabongs are teeming with fish and some other unusual delicacies that are also a favourite food of the Jabiroo.
Most of the permanent billabongs around Kakadu are home to a water snake called a file snake. File snakes are traditional food of the Aboriginal people around here. In the late 70s, I was privileged to be asked to go out on a file snake hunt.
I was accompanying the Gengali family on a regular food gathering trip. And remember, these billabongs are also home to estuarine and freshwater crocodiles.
What the women are doing here is they're looking for file snakes, which live in the bottom of the lagoons here, in these big billabongs. They live there on the mud and they feel for them with their feet, and they pull them out and kill them with their teeth, put them in the mouth and pull them like that to break their necks.
Arafura file snakes are non-venomous and are common in the billabongs of Kakadu. They live permanently in the water but need to surface about every 20 minutes to breathe fresh air. This gives them protection from predators such as the Jabiroo and sea eagles. But the file snake is no match for the skills of the patient hunters. After about 4 hours in the slimy mud and murky water, the women had three prize file snakes and showed me how they killed them.
The skin of the file snake's very rough, just like the file, in fact, and that's where the name comes from.
File snakes are highly valued as food by the local people, and to conserve the stocks in the billabongs, they're only taken in the right season when the snakes are in their best condition. Back at camp, the file snakes were cooked on hot coals buried under paper bark and dirt. This one is full of eggs, a prized delicacy, saved for Grandma to enjoy. The most famous waterway in Kakadu is Yellow Water Wetlands. These World Heritage wetlands are easily accessible by taking a cruise in one of the Yellow Water cruise boats. Yellow Water is part of the South Alligator River floodplain. It's a permanent body of water that's open all year to visitors. This cruise is a must-do on anyone's itinerary to Kakadu. It allows you to get up close to a large variety of bird life and see some amazing wetland scenery. Magpie geese are busy feeding on native water chestnuts and take no notice as we drift by. Whistling ducks also stay put as we move on to the flooded paper bark forest. Estuarine crocodiles also inhabit this pristine waterway. Egrets perch in the trees as we pass through this water wonderland. Looking like a waterlogged primeval forest, yellow water is a large tranquil landlocked billabong in the dry season. During the wet season, yellow water becomes part of Jim Jim Creek and the South Alligator River system. These are some of the most important tropical wetlands in the world. In the afternoon light, yellow water lives up to its colourful name. Agile wallabies can be observed in the evenings as they feed on new green grass. They inhabit low-lying areas on the edges of billabongs. Frogs happily feed beside the wallabies. The cheeky willy wagtail gives this wallaby a bit of a poke up the tail. The graceful frog is Australia's only native crane. They're big birds standing over a metre in height with a wingspan of 2 metres. A darter or snake bird dries its feathers in the last warming rays of the sun. Waiting for darkness, a rufous night heron hides in a tree. A sunset cruise on yellowwater billabong is a rewarding experience. A rich kaleidoscope of colours dazzle our eyes as the sun sets over yellow water. It's a sight to remain in your memory forever. This really is a special place. One of Kakadu's great day trips, if you have a four-wheel drive, is a visit to Twin Falls in the southeastern escarpment country.
The first part of the road into Twin Falls is very, very corrugated, as you can hear. Sounds like the four-wheel drive's rattling apart. They grade the road every few weeks, so if you're lucky enough to be here straight after the grader, it's quite good until you reach the four-wheel drive section.
Four-wheel drive is recommended for the entire 60-kilometre trip from the Kakadu Highway, even though we find ourselves on a few kilometres of sealed road as we reach the Arnhem Escarpment. From here, it's definitely four-wheel drive only, and it's not long before we find out why.
To reach Twin Falls Gorge, you need to go through a fairly deep water crossing. It's about a metre deep, so you need a snorkel on your four-wheel drive.
This is Jim Jim Creek, which flows north into yellow water and on into the mighty South Alligator River that eventually empties into Van Diemen Gulf, about 160 kilometres north of here. Now we've crossed Jim Jim Creek, there's about 6 kilometres of mostly slow sandy track to the Twin Falls parking area.
The only way to get to see Twin Falls after that rough ride in here is either by swimming or by boat. We bought our own rubber boat. It might be an inflatable lifeboat, but once you get down here, it starts to feel very heavy.
Twin Falls Gorge cuts into the Arnhem Escarpment. Over millions of years, wet season rains have sculptured the sandstone into this magnificent gorge.
Last time we were here was a couple of years ago, and we swam up the gorge. It's about a kilometre swim. It's a long way. This time it's much easier in the dinghy, particularly when Margie's rowing. But it's well worth it no matter what way you get here.
As we slowly make our way upstream, we enjoy the solitude of Kakadu at its finest. We disturb a freshwater croc catching the warm rays of the sun on his own rocky island. Estuarine crocodiles have also been known to inhabit these waters after the wet season. It's a swim at your own risk policy here. You definitely need a boat or inflatable mattress to make the trip up the gorge. There's no walking track at all. The first section of the gorge comes to an end at a huge bowl of strewn blockage. From here it's a scramble over slippery rocks to reach the next large pool. Looking down or upstream, the views are nothing short of breathtaking. Picture postcard scenes that bring back memories of glossy advertisements for the Northern Territory are all around us. A little further up the gorge, another blockage of giant boulders has created a dazzling white, almost artificial looking sandy beach, complete with people in swimsuits. This is as far as we can go up Twin Falls Gorge, and everyone here has made the journey to see this stunning plunge pool and the spectacular Twin Falls.
Well, we've reached Twin Falls, and as you can see, it's well worth the effort. This is the dry season. Imagine what it'll look like in the wet season. It's a fantastic oasis in the middle of Kakadu National Park.
Nearly all the people here are overseas visitors who have come in with tour guides who operate four-wheel drive excursions to the more difficult-to-reach attractions of Kakadu. A lot of private travellers are unsure of crossing Jim Jim Creek and don't want to carry in boats or swim up the gorge. But as you can see, if you make the effort, you'll be rewarded with probably the most scenic gorge of Kakadu in the dry season. It's simply a stunner. The water that flows down Twin Falls eventually ends up as part of the Alligator River's floodplains, which make up most of Kakadu National Park. Gigantic swamplands flood huge areas, creating a wetlands of enormous proportions. Even now in the latter part of the dry season, the extent of the wetlands can only be appreciated from the air. With water comes bird life, and lots of it. The Marmukala wetlands just off the Arnhem Highway are beautiful all year, but most dramatic in the later dry season.
You can get a great view from the observation platform. Plenty of birds here.
I can film the bird life up close without disturbing their daily activities. The majestic egret is happily feeding alongside the lily-hopping jacanas. These sprightly birds are often called Jesus birds because of their apparent ability to walk on water. Sometimes the lilies even give the comb-crested jacana a sense of that sinking feeling. Kakadu has over 80 different kinds of water birds. It's also one of the first places visited in Australia by migratory birds. As well as a covered platform, Marmukala has a hide for observing the birds. Kingfishers and bee-eaters are the most colourful birds you will see here. And there's always plenty of whistling ducks. Much of Kakadu's impressive wetlands are inaccessible except from the air. Flying with thousands of magpie geese is an exhilarating experience. Bird surveys have shown up to 3 million water birds use Kakadu's wetlands, and 85% of them are magpie geese. Magpie geese are quite large, standing nearly a metre in height, with an equally large wingspan. Magpie geese were a favourite food of the Aboriginal people. They killed them with light hunting spears, or with waterlogged throwing sticks. With so many geese in the area, there was always a good supply of food. These scenes of thousands of airborne magpie geese just emphasise the importance of these World Heritage tropical wetlands. Kakadu National Park also protects the entire catchment of a large subtropical river, the South Alligator River. The rivers are the arteries of the floodplains as they meander towards the sea. This is just another special area amongst the 20,000 square kilometres of park. In Aboriginal society, the rainbow serpent spans great lengths of time, takes many forms, and appears in numerous rock paintings all over Australia. It's believed in the dream time the rainbow serpent travelled across the country, creating the landscape, including rivers, mountains, significant sites and prominent features, stopping in remote waterholes to lay in wait and trap the unwary and anyone who breaks tribal rules. Here at Ubeer we can see a painting of the rainbow serpent, as well as mimi or spirit figures known as dynamic figures. This one is painted on the overhanging rock that's about 12 metres above ground level at the main Ubeer Gallery. It makes the hair stand up on the back of your neck when you realise these spirit images are believed to have been painted over 10,000 years ago. In X-ray style, turtles and fish dominate the main gallery. X-ray art is believed to be the most recent art form in Kakadu and Arnhemland. A European man smoking a pipe and another standing with his hands on his hips stand out because they are different, even though they're only small figures in the main frieze of polychrome X-ray paintings.
And way up there, there's a painting of a Tasmanian tiger, or a thylacine. How did he get up there to paint it? That's anybody's guess.
This painting is at least 15 metres above ground level on the rock face under the left-hand end of this huge rock overhang above the main gallery. Tasmanian tigers have been extinct on the mainland for hundreds of years, and this painting is believed to be at least 3,000 years old. On our way up to the lookout and hilltop art sites, we stopped to observe native bees that have made their home in a crack in the rocks near the walking track. Native bees are quite small and have no sting. They were much sought after by Aboriginal people who could collect their honey without being stung. High on the rocky outcrop is another wonderful gallery of art, including this large gun and a European reaching for a rifle. This is regarded as one of the finest galleries of Aboriginal art in Australia, mainly because of this frieze of running and hunting figures painted in white. With animation and movement, this composition is regarded as outstanding in Aboriginal art. The Michelangelo of Ubeer, a must-see in Kakadu.
We're on top of the lookout at Ubeer to have a look at the sunset. You look out across the floodplains.
While we wait for sunset, we take in panoramic views of the floodplains. Ubeer is composed of several large outcrops of sandstone known as outliers and part of the Arnhemland Plateau. In the distance, we can see Arnhemland, our destination in the next couple of days. Because Ubeer is close to a rich source of food in the surrounding wetlands and rivers, The rock shelves were favourite wet season occupation sites for generations of Aboriginal people, up until the mid-1970s. In the evening light, we contemplate visions of hunters returning from the floodplains with geese and fish for their families in these idyllic surroundings. It's been suggested by archaeologists that human occupation of this area could date back 60,000 years, and the Ubi occupation sites could have been in use for up to 22,000 years. Generations of Aboriginals could have witnessed wonderful sunsets like this from the same lookout for a very long time. No wonder this area is a world-famous tourist destination. This is Carl's Crossing on the East Allegheny River. The tide is rushing in, covering the concrete causeway that allows vehicles access to Arnhemland. It's too dangerous to cross when it's like this. It's hard to believe we're almost 100 kilometres upstream from the coast. Muddy water and debris are heading upstream. Apart from the logs, there are dangerous estuarine crocodiles to contend with. Big crocs drift along as the tide turns in wait for unwary fish and animals. A couple of dogs were taken here recently. A few years ago, an unwary fisherman was taken by a large croc as he stood ankle deep on the causeway fishing. Apart from the crocs, fast flowing water can be hazardous to four-wheel drives that attempt to cross when the water's too deep. The locals approach Carl's Crossing with caution, and so should anyone intending to cross the river. Photos on the warning sign make this very clear. We're going to cross over into Arnhemland in the morning at low tide. That's when our permit starts.
Before you head off into Arnhemland, make sure you fill up here at the border store. It's the last place you can get fuel until you get right up to the top.
The border store is also a good place to stock up on last-minute supplies. The East Alligator River looks totally different at low tide, and looking upstream, the causeway holds back the water, creating a picture postcard scene in the morning light. It's an easy crossing at low tide.
Well, we've just entered into Arnhemland, and you can't go past the river here without having a permit and a sticker on your vehicle. You have to have permits like this. So make sure you get your permit before you go into Arnhemland.
The first section of road in Arnhemland is good gravel and passes through floodplains and spectacular escarpment country. We soon turn off on a sidetrack.
We're driving along a four-wheel drive track in Arnhemland to a place called Mount Borrowdale, where we're going to stay for 4 or 5 days.
Very few vehicles use this remote track, which leads to Mount Borrowdale, about 60 kilometres northwest from the border of Arnhemland.
Have you ever fancied staying in an African safari camp? Well, you don't have to go all the way to Africa. You can stay in a safari camp here in Australia, in Arnhemland at Mount Borrowdale.
Davidson's Arnhemland Safaris lease 700 square kilometres of pristine wilderness from the local Aboriginal people. And here, Max Davidson has set up a comfortable, well-appointed base camp in the bush.
Max, how long have you been actually at Borrowdale?
Well, the traditional owners of the area invited me out here in 1986. Most fantastic area in the world, as far as I'm concerned, and we started to find all the Aboriginal art. And that hadn't been known about for many, many years, been forgotten. The people were taken away back in the 40s, so the link was broken with the art. And it's gone from not just being a wildlife and fishing area, but to being one of the best areas of Aboriginal art and culture in the whole of Australia.
Arnhemland has large tracts of tropical woodland and sandstone escarpments that very few outsiders get to see. Max is driving us to a very special place that's hidden in this maze of sandstone outcrops. There's no track to follow after leaving the four-wheel drive, but Max knows this area like the back of his hand, and we're soon looking up at an amazing painting in a cave above us. To reach the cave, we have to work our way around to the back of the sandstone ridge, and we find we can walk right through the rocky outcrop to view this art treasure up close. And what have we got here, Max? It looks amazing.
Well, it's a rainbow serpent. It's a very important part of the mythology of the Aboriginals, and actually, in fact, every race of people in the world have a python or a serpent, or even in South America, the Incas have a plumed serpent, which looks very much like our rainbow serpent. Now, the rainbow serpent hasn't got to be anything particularly at all. Obviously, the body is serpent-like, and it's to do often with making waterways, rivers. A lot of our rivers up here are a bit like serpents, and to do with water holes. The structure, the head of it, can be anything. It can be some have like a kangaroo-type head or a wallaby-type head. Some have shark, some have crocodile. This one seems to be a combination of many things. It's got quite long teeth, and you know, it could be a shark, but it's got a tongue, so it can't be a shark. The tongue's not forked, so it can't be a python. It has a tongue, separate tongue, so it can't be a crocodile. So it's a combination. It's what the person perceives it to be when he is doing his story about the rainbow serpent.
And did you find this?
Yes, I did, 1987. Not that long ago, is it? My wife and I have been out looking at a waterhole over further as a camping site, and we decided to walk across a little gully, up a gully and over a saddle, this little piece of rock going through here. Came back down the other side, and I just happened to look out from down the bottom, look straight up, and saw that head facing out the cave. And I couldn't believe it. It was an incredible sight.
From a serpent in a cave, we're taken to see a reptile in the billabong. This is the biggest estuarine crocodile Max knows about in the area, and we can get up close in Max's boat.
And this is how close you can get to a real live crocodile. This one's about 12 foot, and this is at Max's place.
The giant croc looks very menacing, but at the same time, it looks like a big plastic model. It's amazing how crocodiles can remain motionless, giving their prey a sense of security, until they get close enough to be grabbed.
If the back leg has come forward, you go. As long as it doesn't take off into the boat. I'm sitting near the edge, I'm on the back here.
Docile to amazingly fast in real quick time. In the dry season, Cooper Creek becomes a wetland with a long billabong curling around the impressive bulk of Mount Borrowdale. This amazing waterway is a wildlife paradise and one of the exclusive features of the Mount Borrowdale area. The best way to see it is by boat. Max imitates the sound of a male brolga and gets the brolgas to dance for our cameras. We won't try that with the crocodiles, we know how quick they can be. Estuarine crocodiles are potential man-eaters, so there is definitely no swimming in this billabong. A boat is an ideal platform for viewing the crocs and the abundant bird life of the wetland. The lone pelican isn't too worried about our presence. This is a 2 metre freshwater crocodile. They're regarded as harmless to humans and mainly eat fish. Their snouts are narrower than the dangerous estuarine crocodiles. The wetlands are a favourite habitat for magpie geese. The lush grassy areas surrounding the billabong attract all types of wading birds, including the majestic jabiru, Australia's only native stork. And there's another estuarine croc. The place is alive with crocodiles. In 1971, the estuarine crocodile population in the Northern Territory was down to 5,000 after years of croc shooting. With crocodiles now protected, the present crocodile population is around 60,000. All the water birds have to be extra wary. They could just be a snack to one of these prehistoric reptiles. Aboriginal people hunted and fished this billabong and used art to record their daily lives. A favourite subject was fish.
This is a good one here.
Yes, it appears to be a black brim, or sooty grunter. You see by the shape of the head. It also appears to have a fish spear.
Oh, through the head?
Three then. Prongs, spear in the head of it. Yeah, I suppose someone was maybe misspearing a a black brim, and he's painted that to remind himself not to miss again.
So this is a fishing story.
Oh, very quickly.
It was this big.
It was that big.
And Max assures us the fishing stories from the billabong here are nearly as good. So to prove it, we're out fishing with Max. Lisa, one of Max's guides, hooks the first fish.
That's a barramundi.
That's a good one, Lisa.
That's a barramundi. Congratulations.
Where's Max?
I won't lose it, my friend. No, I better hold it with you.
Yeah.
Look at that. Margie and Lisa try it again, as Max offers suggestions. In no time, Lisa hooks another barra.
Hey! Congratulations again. I can't keep on shaking your hand, you know that, don't you?
With two barra in the boat, Margie is desperate to catch a fish and swap sides with Lisa. Margie's disappointed, but Lisa hooks another one almost at the same time. And this one's a real fighter.
They're getting bigger, Lisa.
Max reveals the secret of catching a barra at Borrowdale.
He came out here with a group of fishermen. We went out left-hand billabong. That's the only lure we use. And nine guys in 5 days threw back 250 barramundi.
Oh, my God.
I've been using those lures ever since, and they've always worked. How about four? Nearly just on 5 kilos.
How about that three? What in, about 15 minutes?
About 15 minutes.
Yeah.
Pretty bad. Lisa three, Margie none. But who cares, it's been a great day and we all get to eat the barra.
What's that, 10?
10 weeks.
10.5 kilos of fish in 15 minutes.
When you come to Borrowdale, you don't need to bring your own tent. You've got these upmarket tents, and you've even got a proper bed. This is camping in style.
And after a relaxing breakfast, we hop aboard one of the camp's safari trucks. Max has promised us a day we will never forget.
When you're at Davison Safari Camp, you get around in a safari truck. It's quite good fun.
We're heading to an isolated area that was once inhabited by Aboriginal people. They always chose to occupy sites close to a food and water source. Just near this lush swampland is some rugged sandstone country. Max leads us through this trackless maze of rocks and crevices that takes us into the mountain itself.
Watch your head on the rocks, see? Hello. There's a few bits of art in here as well.
We're not the first people to enter these natural catacombs, as we soon discover.
On the left-hand side here, the male, and the one here is a female figure. But the whole area has been an occupation site, and it's nice and cool, as you can see. Beautiful water-washed caverns. It's all sandstone. It would have been under the ocean millions of years ago. The hand sits up there. It looks like a fairly young person, or maybe even a female hand. Hand stencils are a signature. They put the hand on the rock and then blowing the ochre from their mouth over it to form a stencil.
We continue through the labyrinth of tunnels and pillars that seem to be almost endless. Eventually, we emerge from this natural rocky maze into a surreal landscape that could be from another planet. We're confronted with pictures of alien-like beings painted on every rock face, including the underside of rock overhangs. These amazing paintings of spirit figures are so precise and detailed, they take our breath away as we try to take in the weird landscape and equally strange beings that adorn the rocks all around us. These female and male spirit figures must have been of tremendous importance to the artists. What they were trying to communicate with these marvellous pictures is now lost in time, a bit like the landscape here. At the entrance to a small cave, we recognise a frill-necked lizard and some fruit bats, painted near a time capsule of artefacts that Max discovered hidden in a rocky crevice in the cave. Some of these items are from Aboriginal contact with outsiders, including Macassan traders from Indonesia, and could be hundreds of years old.
Golden Black, London, number 4, so it'd be tobacco by the centre. I don't know if the number 4 cut in snuff or not. The Macassan adze was used to make dugouts. Wallaby teeth, been used for carving wood, quite sharp. Dominoes, this one is made from rosewood, which is Indonesian. It possibly came down the Macassans. Again, they say the Macassans taught them how to smoke that tobacco, and that possibly was a hollowed-out stick used to smoke tobacco in. It's a ball of beeswax from the native bee. It's been used to hold the bindings on fishing spears, also used in the mouths of didgeridoos.
Continuing our walk and scramble through this sandstone maze, we come face to face with this isolated painting on a smooth quartz pillar. It appears to be a family. A tall dominant figure has a headdress or a teased hairdo and Popeye-like muscles. The smaller figures could be children at his side. A family portrait maybe? And just nearby on another isolated rock is a life-size painting of a mother giving birth. A short walk now takes us to a large natural arch cave.
Well, this area here we call the major arch. It's major, not in significance, it is very significant of course, but it's major in the amount of art done in these caves. There's three very large sites in this area, this one being the largest. Now, talking to George Salupka from the museum in Darwin, he voiced the opinion that it's possibly one of the best sites, if not the best in the world, for the amount of art there is here. Now, we've only known about this cave since 1987. We decided to walk through the rock country from behind us there and stumbled through the catacombs and found this rock face. And I'd consider it one of the major parts of my life, of having stumbled across this piece of art.
Look at the detail in these paintings, they're absolutely stunning. Here we've got a grinding stone and some ochre. We've actually ground the ochre up in the rock here by rubbing it round and round like that to make these paintings behind us here. All these artefacts were found here as they are. There's quite a lot of hand paintings on the wall here. These blue ones were done with Reckitt's blue, the old washing powder. The missionaries brought those in so they can date the age of these paintings.
Intricate hand paintings cover the main wall, with paintings over paintings, including a Macassan sailing ship. And if we look very closely at this patchwork of paintings, we can see a man smoking a pipe, as well as flintlock pistols, and rifles.
The art here we're looking at, what we can actually see, is a decorative X-ray, or referred to as decorative X-ray. And Chilipka mentions in his chronography that these styles could go back one and a half, maybe even 2,000 years ago. These drawings, of course, would have been drawn to make the fishing or hunting a lot better, to remind you not to miss these animals when you went hunting. And then, of course, we have all our female figures, some beautiful female figures. One right above me here, quite possibly a spirit figure. No one really knows that the chain of stories have been broken, and most of these stories have been lost, which is a shame.
If only these spirit figures could speak, what stories they could tell. We can feel the sanctity of this cave. It's like being in a natural cathedral. It's awesome, and like nothing we've experienced before. Today, Max is going to show us how the Aboriginal people survived in the bush around here. Our first stop is this freshwater swimming hole, where the ground is moist and the vegetation is lush, and there's a feed to be found.
So this is a native gooseberry.
It's
tastes very nice, actually. Just a little bit like a tomato, only a bit sweeter.
It's all very nice,
aren't they? Oh, yeah. How many does it take to get
diarrhea? We're going to find out. That's what I'm trying to feed a few more to you.
I hope Max is just kidding. The green foliage also attracts annoying but useful insects.
When you're walking through the bush in the tropics, you'll come across lots of green tree ant nests. Don't brush up against them because you can get bitten. They don't actually sting, they just hang on and bite.
These plentiful ants have very strong jaws and can really hang on, which is how they grip and pull in the team, dragging the leaves together, whilst other ants bind them together with threads from ant larvae to create their leafy home. The Aboriginals found a medicinal use for these ants, as Max demonstrates.
Well, who's going to smell it?
I really have to smell it.
Yeah.
Oh, gee.
It's a green ant nest. The green ants in it were squashed. What you're getting is the formic acid. And the formic acid actually helps to clear the head out. Aboriginal people say it's good for clearing the sinus. Mix it up in water. The water will go white, milky colour, and you drink it for cold.
We leave the lush area to go into the dry woodlands in search of the small bush potato, a favourite with Aboriginal people.
Yeah, bush potato. Well, that's the plant you look for. That's what we're doing, walking around looking for that plant. And you sometimes get up to three of these on the base of that plant. Who's going to try it? A few.
It's just like a raw potato.
They're called bush potato. Walking around digging that up, and that's how you survive.
At our next stop, Max explains some of the uses of termite nests.
And there are two distinct types of termites. The ones that eat the grass. Then we have the wood-eating termite that actually eats the forester. These are red because they're living in ironstone country. So there's quite a high iron content in the termite nest. The termite nest is very high in minerals. So Aboriginal people would eat part of the termite nest as a mineral replacement. It's very dense and very hard. And if you're cooking Aboriginal style, and you may be cooking in the ground oven, scoop a hole in the dirt, put logs in there, and put pieces of termite nest on it, because the termite nest will hold heat. Put leaves of melaleucas in there, your food, the hot pieces of termite nest, and then cover the whole lot with a big sheet of paper bark, or melaleuca bark, and seal it with dirt, and it steams the food. So the humble old termite, pretty useful little insect. The interesting part about these plants, you can take the centre growing leaves and pull them out and use them in basket making, or you can chop down the whole heart of that out and eat it, slightly roasted in the coals or eaten raw. We have a plant called redwood, which give a beautiful red colour. And it's growing just around here, so I'll dig some of it up and we'll have a look at it.
Aboriginals use plant dyes in their craft work.
It's a beautiful red colour. Now to use that, you would pound up with a rock and rub the fibres that you're making your dilly bags into it. It's called red root. This one's called yellow root, and it's a yellow dye. And we'll just take a bit of the bark off them. Now that pounded up will give you a yellow colour. And if you pound it up and rub the fibres into it, it's quite a dark stain. So that's the yellow colour you'll see in the dilly bags. But remember, all these vegetable dyes were used in crafts. When we look at the art, we're looking at different, we're looking at ground up stone. So minerals used in the rock and the rock paintings. Yeah. I happen to have dirty hands, so we'll just take a few leaves, wash them up. I see we've got a lovely young lady here with some water.
Max gives us a washing lesson using a plant he calls soap bush. It's very effective.
Clean hands.
That is clean hands. It does clean your hands right up. They weren't that clean before.
We're now heading towards a large waterhole in this dry country, where Max knows he can find a special plant.
That's called a Cypress javonicus. And it makes a very good paintbrush.
You've got quite a stubby brush there, and for the fine lines like the cross hatching, you can go down to even one or two fibres, and that's what was used in painting on the rocks. And it's still used today in painting when you buy bark painting. So everything you need is here. It's only a matter of looking around the shopping centre. Well, the whole area of Arnhemland, which is just under 94,000 square kilometres, is closed off to anyone else except Aboriginal people, made a reserve in 1931. So it's always been protected away from the general public. And that's the reason why it's still like it is, because no one's had a chance to go in there and take away artefacts or do anything with it. It was just left to its natural state. Most of the owners would have stopped living in the area probably back in the 40s.
We've seen bush medicine, bush tools, and bush fruit and vegetables. Now we're looking at the meat supply. There's enough ducks here to feed an army. All these natural products are here in this outdoor supermarket. The traditional owners certainly knew how to harvest this country.
That's amazing. Can you imagine so many ducks in one place at one time? There must be thousands upon thousands of whistling ducks out there.
Most mornings around the campsite, we see blue-winged kookaburras and whistling kites in the trees and overhead. They're looking for leftover scraps of meat, and they're usually not disappointed. It's a competition between the kookaburras and the kites as to who gets in first. The cheeky and smaller kookaburras dive-bomb the kites in an effort to drive them away from the meat scraps. It's all about bluff. There is no real contact, just lots of noise and close encounters. With the morning entertainment over, we head bush in two safari trucks with Max, David and Lisa as guides for the day. We're heading into a remote section of the Mount Borrowdale area that's home to some very ancient art, as Lisa explains.
This area we call Jabiru Rock. We've got a very interesting selection of different rock art. We've got naturalistic figures, very long, elongated figures, and the grass prints as well, where they would have got the bits of grass, rubbed it into the ochre, and then flicked it up onto the rock face. So here on the rock face, we've got going back to possibly 50,000 years of rock art.
These remarkable haunting images have withstood the test of time and weather. Let's hope they'll still be here in another 50,000 years. We're heading deeper into Arnhemland to an area few people get the opportunity to visit. In this harsh landscape, we find a large rugged sandstone outcrop that's riddled with caves and narrow crevices that go right through to the other side. David leads us into a huge dark cave that's home to a group of rare ghost bats. Our torches penetrate the darkness and we get a rare glimpse of these large grey bats. A unique experience. It's time to leave the ghost bats to settle down as we clamber along this giant crack through the sandstone outcrop. It's a difficult scramble with our cameras, and the temperature on this sunny side of the hill is in the high 30s. It's necessary to be here at this time of the day to get the sunlight on these isolated paintings that are scattered around this side of the outcrop. There are so many remarkable paintings in the Mount Borrowdale area that it makes us wonder how many more there are still to be rediscovered in Arnhemland, which is an area bigger than Tasmania. Not much further down the track, we come to this balancing boulder with a slice from its side. It's almost like it's revealing what's inside this giant jewel of Arnhemland. It's an amazing cameo of art sitting proud in the wilderness. Maybe the artists were inspired by the amazing, bizarre and colourful insects that also inhabit the area, such as this green monster, a giant phasmid or stick insect. They grow up to 25 centimetres long and eat plants. Their name means like a ghost because they blend into their background. In close-up, this grasshopper looks like an alien from a space movie, a bit like some of the paintings around here. These iridescent coloured bugs adorning the leaves of a bush they are gradually devouring have the obvious name of jewel bugs. Now what we've got here, this bright coloured grasshopper, is called a Leichhardt grasshopper. Now where do you find these, Max?
Well, they used to one time be all through the sandstone country in the top end, so we believe. They don't occur in many places now, they're pretty rare. They find one or two in Kakadu every now and again. As you can see, we find quite a few here.
Well, these bushes must have 100 of them.
These juvenile Leichhardt grasshoppers are less coloured and smaller. They've almost stripped this aromatic shrub called Pitarodia. This truly spectacular grasshopper was named after explorer Leichhardt, who collected a specimen in Arnhemland in 1845. It was soon thought to be extinct until it was rediscovered in 1971 near the South Alligator River. The stunning colours deter predators and it's thought the grasshoppers are poisonous. Aboriginals call these orange grasshoppers the children of the Lightning Man, who brings storms in the wet season. It's late in the afternoon and we're cruising along the still waters of Cooper Creek Billabong. We've been promised a sunset to rival the colours in the Leichhardt grasshopper on our last day at Mount Borrowdale. We stop to check out the resident crocs as we slowly make our way north along the Billabong, and they're still pretty active. As the sun gets lower in the sky, we relax and take in the light and colours of this incredible place, a real oasis in Arnhemland. This is one of the richest and most powerful cultural sites in Australia. The Aboriginal custodians have entrusted Mac to share some of these treasures with small numbers of visitors in this remote and exclusive setting. Expect to find no fixed itinerary when visiting this part of the world. The anticipation of not knowing what the next marvellous day will bring is part of this adventure in Arnhemland. Our lookout boat stops in a patch of water lilies as an estuarine crocodile slips into the water to watch the sunset with us. We just soak up the last rays of the sun while sitting back in one of the most amazing places I've ever seen in Australia. We're still in Arnhemland and we're heading north to Cobourg Peninsula. The road along here is a good gravel road, a few corrugations, but a bit like any outback road you'd find. We have about 200 kilometres to go, and there are a few shallow creek crossings along the way. This particular scenic creek catches our attention as we stop to observe a disturbance in the water. Small whitebait are literally being snapped up by large fish, possibly barramundi. A group of pied herons are also enjoying an easy meal. Pied herons are only found in the tropics. Not far past the unnamed creek, we come to the Merganella airstrip and a phone box. When you get to Merganella, you need to put your permit into this little box here. It's for safety reasons, so we better put it in. It's another 135 kilometres to Cobourg through isolated woodland country, and so far we haven't seen another vehicle. Only 15 vehicles at any one time are allowed into Cobourg National Park on Cobourg Peninsula. On arrival at Black Point, we report into the ranger station and drop into the store to pick up a few extra supplies. We also organise a boat trip into Port Essington for later on during our stay. We could camp, but because we only have a few days, we decided to stay in the Cobourg beach huts.
After all our hectic travelling, this is just a great place to sit down and relax, and the view from the Cobourg beach huts is magnificent.
The huts are situated only metres from the beach and overlook the clear blue waters of the entrance to Port Essington. More beautiful sandy beaches fringe the northern shores of the peninsula, and a walk along this isolated coastline can be very rewarding.
Whilst walking along the beach, we noticed this old dugout canoe up amongst the bushes. It's about 11 metres long, which is quite long for a timber canoe. They would have cut it out of a log, and this would have been used by the Aboriginals for hunting out at sea, like turtles, dugongs and fishing. You can see the cut marks here when they've cut it out with an axe. We've no idea how old it is, it's probably washed up here in a storm.
The Arafura Sea also washes ashore thousands of seashells. A few hours walking results in seeing a large variety of seashells, including this large baler shell. Collecting shells in national parks is usually not permitted, so Margie reluctantly puts them back.
When you're walking along the beach and you look at these little rock areas, you'll see lots of little hermit crabs. They're all trying to hide from you. But if you sit still for a while, they'll start moving around again. They're quite interesting to watch.
Hermit crabs live in old mollusk shells and retreat inside for protection. They come out and walk across the sand, creating tiny tracks that sometimes cover the beach. They're not very big, but there are hundreds to be seen on these deserted beaches. They're not really crabs, they're long-tailed decapods, born with soft tails and no shells. They take up residence in mollusk shells and use their soft tails to hook themselves into the shells. As they grow, they find a larger shell to live in, upgrading to the latest model in hermit crab mobile homes. We're heading south into Port Essington with Gary and Alison from the Goorig store. A boat is the best way to see Port Essington, as the national park has very few tracks that access the port's shores. We stop off to explore the amazing red cliffs that make up a large part of the port's coastline. Back in the aluminium boat, we continue past the colourful cliffs to pristine white beaches, but unfortunately, no swimming once again. Too many crocodiles.
You've heard of the saying, only take photos and only leave footprints. Well, here you can certainly leave your footprints on these isolated beaches in Port Essington. This is just one of dozens of isolated beaches.
You can have most of Port Essington's beaches to yourself, apart from the odd flock of noisy terns. Around these beaches you may also see the colourful creeping hibiscus. Aboriginals eat the white tuber roots of the plant. It's like a white carrot and apparently tastes quite good. We're now entering a different world, a world of predominantly green mangroves, quite different to the colours of the open port.
This is Cayman Creek, just like the Everglades.
We're travelling inland by boat. We're now into the freshwater part of Cayman Creek, with still waters and mirror reflections. This Everglades section is a hidden treasure in Goorig National Park's 4,500 square kilometres of area. A curtain of giant tree roots blocks us from going further upstream. This odd shellfish is also a favourite food of the Aboriginal people of Goorig. It's a mud whelk. Locals call them long bums. In tropical areas you can often see a variety of tree snakes. This brightly coloured green tree snake is a python and harmless to humans. Cayman Creek also has crocodiles. After all, a caiman is a South American species of crocodile. The eastern headland at the entrance to Port Essington is called Smith Point. It's marked with a large stone beacon. This is the first indication of how close we are to some fascinating history of the area.
This navigational beacon was originally built in 1845 to aid the vessels that were entering Port Essington. There's a big reef just out there.
the ships were heading into the port to visit the military settlement of Victoria. The port now provides a safe anchorage for yachts that are passing by. We're boarding the Gurig Store's fast aluminium boat to visit the forgotten settlement that lies in ruins 30 kilometres south inside Port Essington. In 1845, it was hoped that this huge port would be a major stopover for steamships on their way from England via Singapore to Sydney. And eventually, this now quiet place could have been the site of a major city and an important trade port in northern Australia. There's no land access to the forgotten settlement. All visitors have to come by boat, and for that reason only a small number of people per year get to see this historic place. We're about to take a 4 kilometre walk from this remote and windy beach in Port Essington to explore the ruins of Victoria Settlement that was built by the British in 1838. Built in 1838, abandoned in 1849, Victoria Settlement now lies in ruins amongst the tropical vegetation. This is all that remains of the old blacksmith shop. The British considered it necessary to have a European settlement on the northern Australian coastline to deter the French and Dutch, who were expanding their colonies in the southern East Indies. After two failures, Victoria was the third attempt at a military presence in the north. Four ships sailed into Port Essington in October 1838. On board were new settlers, marines and women and children, all with great expectations for their new surroundings. They soon built a 43-metre long stone jetty and raised the flag. A cyclone destroyed the jetty 12 months later. A second jetty was built, and today its remains are overgrown by mangroves. A lime kiln was constructed to fire shells and coral to produce lime mortar for the many buildings in the settlement. One of the best preserved buildings is the magazine. Ammunition for the garrison was stored in this very well constructed magazine, with 40 centimetre thick walls. It's half buried into the ground to minimise damage in the event of an explosion. The fort that was here was deliberately blown up and the settlement was abandoned in 1849. With little knowledge of the tropics, the settlers got it all wrong. Their gardens produced disappointing crops. The soil was poor, not like they were used to in England. The married quarters cottages were all built with Cornish-style chimneys and open fireplaces. Who needs an open fire in the steamy conditions of the north? The temperatures in the summer months were over 40 degrees Celsius and the humidity was almost 100%. And still the garrison's Royal Marines were dressed in thick, hot uniforms that were more suited to colder European climates. The mosquitoes and sandflies of the area also made life very unpleasant, particularly for the women and children. Everyone in the settlement spent some time here. This is all that remains of the hospital. Sickness overran the place. Dysentery, diarrhea, influenza, scurvy and malaria took their toll. The hospital was often overcrowded, with half the garrison's men all with fever. During these times, medical supplies ran low, and very little maintenance was carried out. The building soon started to fall into disrepair. To make matters worse, two shipwrecks in 1845 saw the settlement having to cope with the shipwreck survivors as well. Local ironstone was commonly used in the buildings, and it's withstood the ravages of the tropical climate. White ants and fire have destroyed all the timber in the settlement buildings. The cemetery has to be one of the most isolated cemeteries in Australia. Out of a total number of 149 residents who lived at Victoria Settlement, 43 died. That's a very high percentage of deaths. Almost one-third ended their days here. There are only five tombstones in the cemetery. The others who died here must have been buried in unmarked graves, lost now in the surrounding bush. Expectations of a major shipping and trading post like Singapore were dashed, with only 78 ships calling in over 12 years. That didn't include the five warships that were stationed here. Faced with these facts and the difficulties of life here, the Colonial Office could see no valid reason to maintain this lonely outpost on the North Australian coast. So the order was given to withdraw the Royal Marines. Victoria settlement was abandoned to the elements.
We've travelled 1,950 kilometres in 19 days and used 315 litres of diesel to drive from that remote beach in Kakadu to an even more remote beach here in Arnhemland. This is just one of the many pristine beaches of Cobourg National Park, and it's a wonderful place to end our journey through Kakadu and beyond. We've travelled through a timeless land, seen some amazing pictures from the past and filmed prolific wildlife, and all this is in Australia. So don't forget to join us the next time we travel all over the countryside.